Hello everybody and welcome to another War Thunder upcoming content video. We're taking a look at the Q&A that was released a couple weeks ago on the 26th of May that I wanted to do a video on, but I'm only getting to it now. This, as per usual when I do these videos, these are included in my dev blog series because they tend to talk about development and possible future additions, etc. And I read the question. I usually do these blind, and I'm doing this one mostly blind. I do know about a couple things that were mentioned through this. But we'll read the question, and I'll react to the question. If I have an opinion on the question, I'll state it, and then we read the answer to that question, and so on and so forth. Usually these are a great way to get a lot of salt flowing. But whatever. Let's go ahead and begin right off with aviation questions, starting with... Has there been any more work or news on a drop tank feature for aircraft? This would really help a lot of aircraft with limited fuel in battles and allow for more tactical choice and longer engagements. So I remember a long time ago, I swear, fucking like maybe even 6 years ago, people wanted drop tanks in the game. And I think you, on some aircraft, you can actually get tanks of fuel. It just depends on how much you're carrying, but you can't drop them. they're just part of your aircraft, provided you don't have, or provided you're using one of the aircraft that does that. So I don't really know, per se, the advantages. I guess it would have to, I mean, during confrontation, I could see such a thing being useful in maybe some aircraft realistic. I've never had an issue with fuel unless I take too little of fuel for certain aircraft in air realistic at least. But the answer is yes. For top ranked battles, it's already under consideration. I think we'll start to work on it next year. So there you go. If you want drop tanks or were interested in drop tanks of any sort for whatever reason, they're at least being worked on or planned to be worked on next year at some point. Which is good. So moving on, we have the next question, which is a fucking huge. Oh, okay. This is one of the ones that I was made aware of ahead of time. So previously, you announced that you would remove non-historical and incomplete vehicles from the German ground tree that were never fully completed and introduced replacements. Could you tell us if you have any long-term plans to remove and replace the R2Y2 series of aircraft in the Japanese aircraft tree? Both the Kawasaki T1, capable of mounting bombs and sidewinders, as well as the Kawasaki P2J, bombs and torpedoes, are in line with the positions that the R2Y2s already occupy. There is also the more advanced Kawasaki T4 that can also supposedly carry bombs and gun pods. All of these would be more grounded replacement options than the three R2Y2s. Now, I've made myself very clear on the channel in the past, and I will still continue to make it clear, regardless of the R2Y2's information that you can find on the internet. Gaijin is exceptionally inconsistent as fuck when it comes to this shit, and they will continue to be inconsistent as fuck. We all remember when Gaijin went all panties in a twist for those German vehicles that they were removing from the tech trees to replace them with not great replacements. And then shortly thereafter, they went and added an event vehicle that was never fully completed, just because why the hell not? It completely went against everything they had just stated for, but I guess you could make the argument, well, at least it's not on the standard tech tree. But they also make the exception for large ships never being fully completed, but having been laid down or began construction or had been planned, etc., to also be applicable to coming to the game. Even the recently announced Soviet battlecruiser is one of those vessels. Those were never fully constructed, but they're being added to the game. I don't care what the reason is. I don't care if it's because so that they can counter other nations' vehicles that existed. That doesn't matter. The same logic still applies. The vehicle was never completed, and it's being put in the game on the tech tree to be researched as a never completed vehicle. I'm not complaining about that. I fully support that. But this logic and inconsistent bullshit is what I do not agree with how Gaijin handles their vehicles in the game and have been the past few years ever since they went and took things like the Cerulean out. Which again, the Cerulean was its turret was mocked, I believe, had a wooden mock-up of it. The vehicle itself existed. You know, that vehicle, why did that one have to go? Because it was partially built, then why did you add a partially built wooden mock vehicle afterwards? I don't know. And then they turn around and they show us an advertisement teaser of a South African vehicle in during its original tease. And then later, that vehicle was never added to the tech tree, and the reason that was given was, oh, well, that vehicle was never actually made. It was just, its weapon system existed as a wooden mock-up, and that was it. And we never said that the vehicle shown in the teaser would actually be added, even though that's exactly what that type of advertisement video should be doing. You know, the consistency in their logic is fucking awful, and it has not changed since they started doing this crap. So, that's where I stand on it. No, I do not believe the R2-Y2 should be taken off the tech tree, because the logic just makes no fucking sense. But, whatever. You know, I'm not going to complain about adding other vehicles, like these T1s and T4, or this T-Series, etc. I'm assuming Gaijin will make it that decision down the line, and will probably still remove them from the tech trees. Obviously, if you own them, you keep them, but that is just kind of like a slap in the face to anybody that isn't around or hasn't been around for owning those units. And the response is, we can talk about their withdrawal from the game once we have a replacement ready for these aircraft. It's already in our plans. Now, I'm assuming it's been in their plans for a long time. I don't know what their planned replacements are. I hope that, I mean, a lot of people have brought up the R2-Y1 with weapon systems before, you know, since that was a vehicle that existed and was fully built and operational, but whatever. I'm passing that one because there's a lot of salt that I have on those topics. So the next question is, could you clarify if it's possible that we will see South African aircraft in the British tree too, now that they have ground forces within their tree? Currently, there is only the Rhodesian Hunter as a premium aircraft. Okay, so I'm assuming they're talking about like maybe a tech line, their own tree line or whatever on the tech tree, like how South Africa has their own dedicated line on the ground forces tree. I mean, obviously, more aircraft, more units, when they're not trying to remove them from the game is really nice and really good. Doesn't matter what they are, so I wouldn't be against this idea at all, and I don't really see a reason to keep them from the tree. I mean, if they don't want to put them on the tree, then they could still go at the old school, you know, make them a premium or an event vehicle or something like that, like they've done before. The answer is, the British aircraft research tree is already quite representative. 5 lines as opposed to 4 in the ground vehicles tree before South Africa was introduced. South African aircraft may be added in another capacity as a premium event or squadron vehicles. Okay, just like I said. Now, I do have one little minor annoyance to bring up, and that's that it was only 4 lines because you made it 4 lines. You could have easily still made it 5 lines by splitting up certain vehicles. But whatever. If that's the logic we want to use here, then I'm not gonna try to argue it. The next question is, has there been any more developments regarding working on removing air-to-air missile spool up or shut-off timers? With more and more modern jets, these can sometimes adversely impact battle situations due to the reaction times of these timers. Perhaps a compromise situation where some elements of actual known characteristic spool-ups, shutoffs of each missile could be implemented rather than a singular time like how it currently is. I have no fucking clue what the hell they're talking about. So I cannot put an opinion forward on this, but the answer to it, in case you are wondering, is while we are at the stage of gathering information on our collection of air-to-air missiles, you can't find such information for all missiles, unfortunately. The mechanic change itself is simple, a change in the value of the missile configuration file. We think within 1 to 2 major updates, the decision will be made and changes will also be made. So if you're wondering about that question, there's your answer. That's not my area of play, even though I have played a lot of jets recently. I haven't played air-to-air missile jets. The next question is the appearance of the UAV, an unmanned aerial vehicle, in the game possible, and in what form? A separate vehicle type, or as a modification for ground vehicles type of an idea? Now, okay, this is interesting. Now, I do know that there was a UAV that was kind of available. I don't know, it was a bit weird, in one of the previous April Fool's events, I think last year's, which I didn't take part in, but I've seen footage of. In fact, just the other day, I watched a YouTube video of someone flying around that wicked aircraft and using the guided bombs, which was the most fucking broken thing I've ever seen. So please, for the Christ's sake, if you're gonna add that kind of shit to the game, give us a tank-only option. For fuck's sake, please. Because I really don't need my game ruined even more by that kind of shit. But the implementation of such a vehicle or such a unit, I don't really know how to refer to it, I think is still is very possible. I mean, they've recently, I say recently, but they introduced scout aircraft for large vessels, which I have been able to play with too myself and see how they work. And I mean, this allows you to take one vehicle that you have, launch something completely separate with its own damage model and its own controls, and you can freely swap between the two when you want to move your main vessel or fire your main cannons, then swap back to the scout aircraft and then fly it around cap points, whatever it can do, right? Point is, you can control two different vehicles in the game, you know, in a match. You don't have to, you know, provided you're surviving in one of them. So I think the idea of being able to control some sort of unmanned vehicle, whatever it is possible. I mean, what about hand-launched drones, for example? You know, something like that. I don't know. I guess the whole point of what I'm saying is, I think it's very doable for them to make that work. With how fucking awful Combined Battles balance is right now, I really don't want to see it anytime soon until they figure some fucking shit out with it. And they're not worried about figuring shit out with it because they think it works perfectly fine. But the answer is, it is possible. It is very early to say how this will be exactly, but one of the variants is how it was implemented in the last April Fool's event. So that's actually just what I mentioned. I'm assuming that's what they're talking about. They say last April Fool's event, and I don't know if they're talking about the Arrakis one, because I don't remember any UAVs in that. I'm assuming they're talking about the one from the previous year. Just a moment. Okay, so moving on. The next question is, in most of the missions in Aircraft RB, realistic battles, destroying bases with bombing has no effect on the victory points of the enemy team. It means that bombing bases in such missions is completely pointless and bombers are more or less like ballast for the team. Do you plan on doing something with that? What? That's not true at all. Am I misunderstanding this, or has this person never played Aircraft Realistic? When you bomb a base, when you destroy the base, maybe they just mean when you bomb it, but don't destroy it. When you destroy it, their victory tickets do fucking drop. They drop, so do yours when your base is destroyed. The only issue I have with base bombing is that it's really underwhelming for bomber pilots. There's no stats or much reward or anything to be gained off of it. You get very little in comparison to, let's say, an attacker that's destroying columns of vehicles. They'll walk away with more silver, more RP, they'll drop the tickets much faster, etc., etc. I think that they should add a little bit more variety for bomber pilots to give them more to do or more reward or something along those lines. But regardless, destroying a base very much does affect the victory points. So let's see what the answer is. What you are describing looks like a bug. Bases should affect mission points. If this happens in any of the missions, please report it by using our special reporting system or leave a comment. Okay, so yeah, the response is basically what I would expect. If it is happening, then it shouldn't be happening, because for as long as I can remember, since bases were a thing, you drop their tickets by destroying the bases. Okay, so moving on. Next question is, will there be an interface update in air battles for top-ranked fighters, like it is already implemented for helicopters? I guess I know the helicopter UI they're talking about, but I don't really know about the air UI. Well, if they don't have one, then I guess I wouldn't know. The answer is yes, we have such plans. So if you wanted an updated UI for high-tier jets, then I guess you will be getting that at some point. The next question is, will there be bombers with the ability to carry any winged missiles like the Tu-22 is doing? I don't know. Sounds kind of neat. Sounds, again, like it's going to just destroy fucking ground battles again. But it sounds neat, I guess, the implementation. I would see no reason as to not doing that, but at the same time, maybe not anytime soon. The answer is, for now, there are no targets in the game for such aircraft and weaponry systems. Perhaps in the future, when these targets will appear in the game, such aircraft may be implemented. Okay, well, there you go. There's your answer. I don't really have anything else to say on that. And that's it for aviation, so load of old ass. The next, for ground forces, which is very interesting. I'm very curious to see what this oh my Jesus Christ. Okay. Let us begin. The Swedish top-tier STRV-122s have gone quite some time without receiving new shells. Despite many new tanks and shells for other nations since their introduction, and the penetration of their current shells now falls quite significantly behind most nations, Has there been any more consideration into giving these tanks new shells? In particular, the SLPPRJ-M95, whatever the f*** that is, given Sweden is also lacking a third rank 7 MBT, has there also been any consideration into something like the STRV-121 late or the STRV-121 Barracuda that could be given M95 as a good in-between tank between the current STRV-121 and 122s? Now, I don't play top-tier Sweden yet, so I can't say, you know, from personal experience about these issues, but there has been a lot of new shells added, so I can at least understand why someone might be upset that Swedish MBTs aren't receiving that type of thing if they haven't been receiving that type of thing. And of course, the addition of new tanks is going to always be really exciting. And the answer is, the Swedish 122 has high efficiency statistics in addition to its own features. Compared to all the Leopard 2s in the game, it has the best armor protection. However, we are considering the option of a new shell for the next modification of the STRV-122. I'm assuming when they say next modification, they're implying a new addition to the game. I'm not sure. But whatever. That's your first one if you are a Swedish player. Moving on, the next one is, will we see the double feed system in vehicles that had it? Currently changing the belt to high explosive in the VCC-80/30 requires a full reload, where in real life you have two separate cartridges and loading belts that allow you to select the next round. That sounds really useful, and I mean, I don't have experience with said vehicle, but that sounds really useful. And I would definitely like an addition like that. I mean, I've been, probably since the day Ground Forces were released, I have been begging for a breech change. A lot of vehicles allowed you to remove a shell from the breech and put a different shell in, rather than War Thunder, where you have to fire the shell first. Not all tanks work like that, though, mind you. But it is very annoying when you need to switch your shell, but the only way to switch it is to give your entire position away by firing into the ground or a building or something in order to change the shell and at the same time waste an entire shell. This is kind of along those lines. And plus, if it's a vehicle with an auto gun or a machine gun or something like that, the reload times tend to be a lot longer than just a typical tank shell. So the answer to that question is, such a system is needed and is already in our plans. Okay, there you go. That sounds really useful, and I hope they expand upon that in the future with other vehicles too. Not for this particular system, but the idea of being able to interchange and things. The next question is, will there be any camo netting customization options in the future? Expansions to tank camouflage could prove a good feature for people to make use of. That would be fucking great, mainly just in regards to tank customization. I mean, I feel like there is, when you look at how tanks can be customized now, it is still very limited, although it is a lot better than it used to be. I mean, you get 6 slots for 3D decorations, which you can really outfit your vehicle, provided you own any of the shit in the game, of which 90% of the 3D decorations are limited time event collectibles that you probably don't have if you're newer to the game, so fuck you. And then you have to spend gold for the other ones, and then you've got 4 decal slots, and then of course you've got the camouflage slot itself for the base paint of the vehicle. There isn't really any customization. I think one of my earliest devlog videos talked about, like, when they had mentioned they wanted to add something like additional tracks and sandbags and stuff. I mean, hell, there's so many different ideas, but that can fundamentally change the 3D model of a tank. You could add that as, say, a premium or a special premium vehicle, like an M4 Sherman with sandbags packed on the front. They could add that as a premium promotional unit or something, right? Or they could give us the option to choose whether we wanted additional tracks or we wanted sandbags on the front of the hull or something, you know. Give us the option to really customize our vehicle so that while everyone might have an M4A2, 5 different people will have 5 different loadouts for that M4A2 with different additional armor or different customization options or something like that per each one of them. Now, camo netting, I saw a video of a Leopard with camo netting from the dev server. I don't know anything about it, though. They haven't done anything on the website for that. I don't know if the camo netting is just a visual change or if it's actually got some sort of effect in the game. I doubt it has any effect. But the idea of having additional customization, or in this case, camo netting, or even just camouflage additions in general, and not just really ugly, nasty, gross-looking, put 5 or 6 bushes on the front of your tank, on every fucking tank, would be really appreciative, especially since camo netting on more modern vehicles looks nice, and I'm hoping it would allow for some kind of actual gameplay, you know, effect rather than just visuals. But I would still live with the visuals anyways, because I think camo netting looks nice. The answer is not planned as a research modification in upcoming updates, so okay, there you go. The next question is, do you plan more artillery, howitzer platforms for the game, particularly for those nations that don't have them yet? There are many iconic examples such as the M109, the PZH2000, the AS90, the FV433 Abbott, the PLZ05, the AMX30 AUF1 that could be considered. Also, mortar gun carrier vehicles with capability to direct fire like the 2S9 Nona S would be very interesting. So, obviously, we've gotten a handful of mobile artillery vehicles in the game recently, and I think we're even getting one with the next major update as well. So, and I don't think there's any reason not to add them. I'm pretty sure Gaijin themselves has said in the past that they are applicable to be added, provided they have a direct fire mode. Kind of like when they weren't going to add the Katusha, but then they found a variant of the Katusha and put it in the game because it has hydromatic suspension that allows you to raise the butt so that you can direct fire. But hell, there are vehicle and weapon systems in the game that can't direct fire, like the new version of the RBT-5. Its rockets cannot direct fire anymore. You have to, unless of course you're on an incline or something like that, but I don't see why we can't have vehicles that can't direct fire, as long as they're not meant for, you know, 400 miles away or something like that. But if all of these can direct fire, then I see no reason why they should be kept from the game. The answer is yes, and one of them, the G6 Rhino, is planned for the nearest major update. So I like how they say one of them, as if, you know, to mention one of the ones that were listed, but looks like they didn't say no to any of these, so they're all applicable in some form, which is nice. The next question is, do you have plans to give light vehicles more capabilities, like set anti-tank mines, Goliath bombs, SDKFZ series, deploy recon drones for modern combat vehicles, and help teammates guidance for missiles? This is really cool. Light tanks in the game, I mean, when you go all the way back to before light tanks had unique mechanics, before there was scouting in War Thunder, light tanks were just that. They were light tanks. They would carry a weapon that was much better than if you were playing something like World of Tanks, where you could actually do something with the weapon. But usually you would have a weapon on a vehicle that was more or less fast and maneuverable, and that was the only benefit. You didn't have armor. You could flank a lot easier, but you could still be outclassed by medium tanks that had the same or a better gun, but had the same mobility or even better mobility, you know. So then they added scouting for light tanks and light vehicles specifically, and unfortunately they decided to change a lot of the vehicles' designations in the game to be historically inaccurate, but to allow for gameplay mechanics like scouting, and that allowed you to spot units, and spotted units show up on teams' minimaps and stuff, at least in regards to realistic battles, and you get reward for those being damaged, etc., whatever. But, you know, that helped to set light vehicles apart from just, you know, better counterparts that you might be able to drive, and gives you a reason to drive those in a way to help your team. So to have more capabilities, I think, would be nice. So anti-tank mines is interesting. We have sea mines in naval forces, and other things like that that you can drop and leave in a position for ships to come across later and get completely obliterated by. So why not something like that for tanks? Light tanks can get ahead in a position, or they can cap a point and drop some anti-tank mines or something like that. There would have to be some sort of counter. You can't just have an invisible mine that will kill you when you drive over it and that's it. There has to be some way to either spot them, or some way for, you know, so that they're easy to miss, so that you can be killed by them, but people that are really paying attention will notice them. You need to have something like that in place if you plan to do that. Goliath bombs sounds fucking dope as hell. I'm assuming they're talking about like the wire remote controlled Goliath anti-tank or anti-position mobile bomb things. They were like these little tanks that basically drove up and exploded on shit. That would be really interesting to see. Obviously they might have a limited range. But again, if we have separately controlled scout planes, you can do this. You can drop things from ground vehicles and allow us to switch between or control a remote controlled thing around. Same with recon drones. Maybe we could control those, or maybe we could just, you know, have them deploy and then they would spot multiple units in like a 360 degree radius or something. I don't know, right? And I don't know so much about the guidance for missiles, but if it helps, it helps. And the answer is some of the mentioned above are possible, yes, but they don't fucking say which ones. I'm assuming the ones that are, at least that I would assume would be most applicable, would possibly be like the anti-tank mines. That sounds like something out of all of these that they would probably do. Maybe the guidance for missiles and maybe the recon drones. I don't know so much about the Goliath bombs, since I think their use was very limited, but because I correct me if I'm wrong, but weren't Goliaths attached by a wire or something like that? So that's what I mean by limited range. But we'll see. Either way, I think some of these would be really interesting and would allow to give you more of a reason. I would also love to see vehicles that just don't always have guns. You know, we have things like the VS-8, which is basically just made to, I mean, of course, I think it has a little machine gun on it or whatever, but it's basically just made to drop mines. Adding more of these abilities gives them the opportunity to put vehicles in the game that just have a mounted machine gun or not, but can drop mines or can perform other capabilities in battle that can help their team, even if they can't just go face to face with an enemy brigade. You know, that gives us more opportunity for vehicle diversity and additions to the game, and I really hope they do that. So the next question is, China is currently lacking a long-range anti-aircraft system for top tier. Are we considering some options to fill the gap? For example, the TOR system used by China could be a good addition. So they're probably talking about like SAMs, long-range SAMs, which China doesn't have. Their top tier AA does have guided missiles, but they're not like contemporary nations, I guess, with their long-range guided missile SAM systems. So I wouldn't be against this at all. Of course, I'm a Chinese main in the game and I love my Chinese ground forces, so I would really, really like to see more AA. Although I do like the AA that they have at their top tier, it is very limited. And the missiles, I've rarely ever gotten a direct hit with any of their missiles. I think I've gotten one missile kill with that vehicle. Otherwise, I just use the auto cannons and they seem to work a lot better. The answer is yes, we have these in our plans. A SAM for long, in the game terms, ranges for Chinese tree. So at some point coming up, in not necessarily the next major update, but within the next couple major updates, I guess we will see a new top tier AA for China, which is very nice. The next question is, are there any plans for a normal implementation of visualization of modern tank sites and fire control systems in particular? Many modern vehicles, the CV90120, etc., have, for example, automatic target tracker, which can be captured, or which can capture air targets and get appropriate calculations for shooting, and can display many indicators of gunners and commander screens, also providing some opportunities to adjust all this. We don't have something like this in the game. I'm assuming they're really just kind of talking about the gun sight view and various other little mini views like that, which is pretty much the same across the board for the most part with some minor changes. I wouldn't be against the addition of this. If we're going to have modern systems and modern vehicles in the game, we might as well make them accurate with their subsystems and stuff. And the answer is there are such plans, and even some in development. So there you go. Next question is, are there any plans for a new visualization of the blast wave impact to the tank from the close bomb explosion, like detonation of an ammo rack with the turret torn off and only the chassis remained, etc.? At the moment, the tank hull just turns black and burns, no matter what happened to it. Ammunition cell explosion or crew died from armor shrapnel. Oh, okay. So they're asking for a more accurate representation of the vehicle's destruction. Because when your vehicle is destroyed, your hull does just turn black. And even if your crew is just killed, like let's say, for example, you get strafed when an open top vehicle and your crew dies, your vehicle does just catch on fire and the whole thing turns black. Now, I'm assuming it does that because for gameplay reasons, so that you can tell which vehicles are dead and which ones are still alive, you know, because vehicles have souls. I'm assuming that's why they do it that way. I don't think they did it like purposefully to be not accurate. But I do think that getting some kind of you know, more visual feedback on damage that's being done or has been done to a ground vehicle, especially considering how much detail is already included in ground forces, would be interesting to see. The answer is there are such thoughts and plans, but require more detailed elaboration. So don't plan on it anytime soon, but they're looking into it, I guess, or have been looking into it. The next question is, are there any plans to add the Object 287 or the Object 787 and similar vehicles? And I'm trying to remember what the fuck these things are because there's a lot of object vehicles. Allow me one moment to look them up on the internet quick. Okay, so the Object 787 is a bit familiar. It's a very weird-looking vehicle with a lot of weapon systems on it. And I, from what I can tell, the 287 is like a guided missile and ATGM carrier. But similar kind of to the IT-1, it looks like, just obviously not because it's an object vehicle, which makes it very weird and unique. But either way, I think seeing the 787 would be really interesting. Give that thing a look up and read up on it, because it is a very interesting looking vehicle. I would hope to see these in some form in the game, especially the 787, because it's really unique looking. The 287, though, I wouldn't complain about. There is a whole freaking collection of objects that could be added that all have these weird designs or unique weapon systems or whatever to them. There's so many out there still. I mean, we've got a few of them in the game, but there's way more to delve into. The answer is, we do not exclude this. So, not necessarily planned, but applicable to be added, which is nice. Okay, now we're moving straight to naval forces. Okay, so let's scroll down. Now, I haven't played naval forces in... Like, I hadn't been playing naval forces for a long time, even when they started adding larger ships, until recently, when a friend basically kind of pulled me into naval forces, and I got to start progressing down a blue water fleet tree, finally, properly, not just, oh, got a couple destroyers, but getting into the heavy cruisers and such. And while this video isn't going to be dedicated to my thoughts and opinions on the naval experience thus far, I would have to say that it's kind of a gray area. There's a lot that I do like about naval forces, but there's also a lot that I don't like in comparison to air and ground modes, which usually heavily weigh towards the good rather than the bad. But I'm very interested to see, but now I feel like I have a little bit more of an understanding of what some of these questions might be pointing towards. So starting off with, will the efficiency of large caliber guns be increased in the game? Often for now, medium caliber guns are preferable to Big Bang because of their rapidity? What is that? I don't know what that is. Maybe some mechanics like overpressure will be added, but only for kinetics, so there won't be a situation where a 155mm shell doesn't do any damage at all. I'm not really sure exactly what they're referring to here now, so I guess all of that buildup about naval forces didn't mean anything anyways. I mean, the only thing I can say about the efficiency difference is that large caliber guns have a long reload, and the accuracy, it can be a little bit willy-nilly. So you get to fire once for every 50 times that the enemy is firing at you. I don't know if that's what they're referring to. And sometimes you'll hit a there was a few times where I'd broadside with my APC BC on my Japanese heavy cruisers, and it wouldn't really do much of any damage. Like, I'd destroy some systems or knock out, you know, I'd penetrate through their side armor or their hull, and I'd destroy some systems, but I wouldn't really do anything amazing to them, while they are just wrecking my surface systems, and then I would end up catching on fire and my ammunition would burn or something like that. Maybe that's what they're referring to, I'm not sure. But the answer to this is also true for reality. The rate of fire with sufficient ammunition power is very important parameter. Okay, so I guess it must have to do with the rate of fire is what they're referring to, which I had already stated. Large cannons do have, you know, you can delete a ship with a large volley. Like, you know, I've done that plenty of times, but I've also plenty of times fired a large volley and waited 30 seconds for my guns to reload while I'm taking hits after hit after hit, because either my shells missed, or they hit but didn't do any significant damage, or something like that. But I guess that's all they have to say on that regard. Next thing is, are there any plans to introduce naval enduring confrontation, which is the most adequate and realistic naval mode at the moment? on a permanent basis. The question that gets asked every time, the question that literally should have no reason to say no to, it is the most idiotic thing to say no to. It's an exceptionally popular mode. It's a mode that gets a lot of attention every time it's brought up. It's a mode that people basically universally love. And yet every fucking time, Gaijin basically says, no, no, we'll keep it a non-permanent basis. We'll keep it as a little mini event every weekend or every other weekend or whatever. You know, no, we're not going to make it permanent every single time they bring it up. So I'm assuming we're going to see the same stupid response this time. And the response is, naval enduring confrontation has its audience and it's quite noticeable. Okay, well then, but it is still considerably inferior to regular random battles. So for now, we plan to make EC available during weekends. Well, maybe it's inferior because you don't let people play the fucking mode. When you relegate it to these certain times or specific dates or whatever, of course the player base is going to be much smaller because not everyone can play on those dates or get the chance to play on those dates. Everyone wants to play it, but you're doing it on days they can't do it. If you make it available all at all times, like say how Simulator Battles works in the event tab, then you will see more players come into it, and you will also allow for more people to notice the mode exists, try it out, and realize, oh hey, I like this, and there you go, your player base explodes and gets bigger in that game mode. You're not going to get a better mode if you don't let people play the fucking thing. That's it. That's all there is for naval forces. Two whole questions. Well, next up is helicopters. Now, I think I was told that they do talk about Chinese helicopters in here. They do. Okay, so right here. First question is, it was mentioned that Chinese helicopters are within plans for the coming updates for some time now. Is that still the case? Are there any details you can share with us about what we can expect? So, with every fucking nation under the sun, including Israel, which is very new to the game, already getting their helicopter tree, and yet China is still missing theirs, which is very frustrating, especially considering multiple Q&As back, they said they were planning to do Chinese helicopters, or that at some point that China would be getting their helicopters. I did my video on that. You can find it. In fact, it should have, I think, a Chinese helicopter in the thumbnail for that video. And yet we still don't have them. So I really hope they are at least in development and not just like, oh, well, we decided not to, or something like that. And the answer is, yes, our plans to introduce the Chinese helicopter tech tree were somewhat optimistic and took more time, but hopefully in the near future we will be able to introduce some Chinese helicopters. Okay, so I guess according to what they say, it took longer than they were expecting, which is, I at least appreciate that more than, no, China just doesn't get their helicopters, but Sweden and Israel and everyone else is getting helicopters out the ass. So the next question is, the premium Apache has been removed from the US tech tree, so when will we finally see a premium Comanche, a legendary helicopter, even if it was never used in combat? When will the MI-24 Super Hind be introduced? Okay, so they actually asked two questions. Now this is great, whoever asked this question. The Comanche is a gorgeous helicopter. And I remember that, I believe at one point I actually mentioned, a long time ago, I mentioned that the Comanche didn't have, or the Comanche, I said I wanted to see the Comanche in the game, and someone said that it doesn't have weapons. That's not true at all. The weapon systems could be mounted on that thing. It was just never used in combat, which I think is where the discrepancy pops up. But the Comanche is a gorgeous looking helicopter. Now, I would see more likely as the Comanche being a squadron vehicle or an event vehicle or something along those lines, while a standard premium would be some kind of special Apache or other attack chopper or something. And then, of course, any kind of MI-24 is going to be bonerific to me, so I wouldn't complain about that. But I would really hope to at least someday see a Comanche in the game. And the answer is, in the future, most likely. That's great, except you didn't specify what you're referring to, because the person said both the Comanche and MI-24 Super Hind. But the way that you answered it makes it sound like you're talking about the Super Hind, when that's the only one that says, when will the MI-24 Super Hind be introduced? In the future, most likely. But also, when will we finally see the premium Comanche? In the future, most likely. Specify, damn it. I guess one of these two helicopters is likely, and I would guess probably the MI-24 is more likely than the Comanche, at least at first. But it is nice to know that someone else out there acknowledges the Comanche's existence. So now we have miscellaneous ones. The next question is, the next question is, will multi-threading be implemented? Currently 100% load of one thread when all the other are by 15 to 20% because of that wildly loses FPS and we get micro freezes. We do get micro freezes. In fact, I noticed that with only the release of the recent major update, I was getting micro freezes. My friend I was playing with gets micro freezes. In fact, we experience the same micro freezes when they occur. When we're playing the game, and we'll see people talk about them, and there are threads online about micro stutters and freezes in the recent update. And for me, for my friend, and for these other people, they started only after the recent major updates. Now, of course, there's always been performance issues, and it's always going to be different for everybody because of how finicky technology and shit is. But when I'm experiencing the same freezes that my friend is experiencing, and other people are also experiencing, yes, there is some kind of micro-stuttering going on. What causes it? I don't know. I'm not qualified to talk about multi-threading and CPU bullshit. I can't tell you anything about that shit. But the answer is, multi-threading is already implemented in the game, but you have to understand that it doesn't always make sense in the game, and not always there is something to occupy a large number of cores. I don't know if that answers the question or not, but there you go. Whatever. But at least they didn't say there isn't micro-freezes, because there has been a lot of that shit recently. The next question is, are there plans for a complete update to the game interface? Now, absolutely all UI, all the fonts, icons in the game are outdated. We would like to see the interface in the style of the Snail Store, Gaijin Store, which it kind of already is in the style of, I don't get what they're saying, which has been updated about a year ago and looks very neat and concise. Now, I have some history with this. The UI update they did was one of the worst updates they could have done. They changed it into a mainstream, boring, bland, piece of fucking junk-looking shit, with the font being the most basic-looking text that you can have. All of the UI text box and everything are just squares that are see-through with an opacity of, like, zero. It's gross-looking in comparison to what it used to be. Tech trees used to have national flags on them. End result screens didn't look like a box with lines and basic font text like you get now. They had, depending on victory or defeat, it was either a sunny, cloudy day or a dark dusk, you know. The medals were all listed up like they were hanging off as rewards rather than just kind of being placed in one little box like they are now on the side of the screen. Everything was stylized and stylistic, and nothing looked outdated, but they wanted to make it look more like a garbage piece of shit 2010s, mid-2010s, I guess I should say, or late by this point, 2020s, future game, you know, how we play our games today, which is by looking bland and uninspired. And I remember making my rant video about that, and then I got called out by another YouTuber indirectly because I had ranted about something you only see for a few seconds, which is total fucking bullshit, by the way, because you will see that screen every match. Plus, you see that UI at all times. It applies not just to the results screen, it applies to the tech trees and the options menus, and when you're in-game, the text boxes, etc. It applies to everything. So I find it funny that we're saying that it looks outdated now, when it looked outdated when they added it, because they removed any style the game had for this really crappy UI that they brought into the game. I would love to see it updated, but I also find it funny that they say more in line with the Gaijin Store, which looks almost identical to how it looks in the game now, with that really mainstream, like, streamlined-looking, gross, boring, bland UI. So I don't really get what they mean by that. The answer is, we have such plans. Okay, well, I highly doubt I have anything to look forward to then. Because if you're planning to make it look more like the Gaijin Store, it's basically going to look like it already does. The next miscellaneous question is, will trees and other bushes be subjected to more physical impact? At the moment, the artillery strike doesn't destroy trees. Some bushes can be destroyed by machine guns, some only by ground vehicle tracks. Some trees cannot be destroyed even by nuclear strike. Can we expect some... Well, nothing's destroyed by a nuclear strike. It's just a pretty looking effect that you get on the screen and maybe a couple things that blow around. Can we expect some single universal formula? Clearing thickets by artillery would be, for example, very useful. I don't really have much to say on this, but I do know what they're talking about, and I wouldn't be against the addition either. The answer is, trees will be damaged and destroyed by artillery fire, and nuclear strike destroys every object on the map. The universal formula, the bigger the tree, the more hits it can hold, or the more powerful the weapon you need to take it down. It's still very buggy. You can shoot a machine gun at a small bush, watch the bush fall over, and then it just pops back up. I don't know. It's what I want most for bushes and trees is a visual update. We get lots of graphical updates to the rest of the game. I think that those look the most outdated right now as far as the graphical fidelity is concerned. The next question is, with Wind of Change update, we received a new map, Sun City, in which players could fight around terrain features like overpasses. In the future, could we see more viaduct and tunnel terrain? Okay, so basically more vertical combat, which can improve the stereoscopic feeling of the scene. That would be really awesome. Instead of having a lane system in the game, we could have, you know, where people are fighting above and even below the middle plane of the map, which would be awesome to see. I think that's really cool. I would totally be okay with that. And the answer is, it is possible. So, some basic stuff, but it's possible. And that's it. Anyways, guys, thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.